What is sense gratification? There are these senses, eyes, ears. Sense gratification is to provide the senses with what pleases them. The eyes like to look at pleasing figures, forms. The ears want to hear what they are programmed to be pleased with. The tongue wants to taste something that it likes. That is sense gratification, right? The question is, philosophers, scriptures, they all seem to be against sense gratification. And in general, it is related that sense gratification and indulgence in sex, in all kinds of other pleasing and gratifying activities, they all go together. So in general, it is assumed that sense gratification is a thing to be condemned. But the questioner is saying that I want sense gratification. I want sense gratification. Sense gratification is not an issue at all, Chetan. Not issue at all. It is not an issue at all because the senses are anyway always looking at the beautiful. You want sense gratification only when you assume that they are not being gratified. Go into this. To want something is a sure proof that you do not feel that you already have that thing, right? When do you want something? When you believe that you don't have it already, that there is something missing. When you feel that there is something missing, you want it, right? This wanting is at the core of all suffering. Wanting in itself is not bad at all. Please understand this. Wanting is just a symptom. The real disease is the assumption that I don't have it. We have been told by wise men, by holy books, that there is something wrong with desire, with wants. But desires and wants are just products of something else. What is that something else? That something else is the assumption, is the belief that I lack in something. Do you understand this? Whatever you want to become, whatever you want to achieve, the very energy for that, the very force for that, the very inclination for that arises from the assumption that I am incomplete, that there is something missing in me, that I am inadequate. Are you getting this? My life is not good right now. When I'll become that, then I'll be all right. When I'll have X amount of money, then I'll feel good, complete. When I'll have a nice spouse or a good house, well, they rhyme together. A nice spouse in a good house. Good. So when I'll have a nice spouse and a good house, then I'll feel all right about myself. Right now, I don't have a right to feel good. This assumption that there is something missing in me, this makes life hell. You're all the time burdened under this thought, and most of us feel that way. Anybody who wants to achieve, who hopes to become, is deeply holding that assumption. What assumption?
That
I do not have this, that I'm lacking in something. And the more you feel inadequate, the more ambitious you are. Do you see the relation?
Yes, sir.
Yes? The bigger is the size of the hole here, the more fierce is the fire. But you call them driven people. You say these are the really motivated ones. They are not the really motivated ones. They are the ones who are really complexed, who are all the time feeling that I'm not good enough. And billions of rupees cannot fill that hole. Whatever you acquire, whatever you achieve, cannot fill that hole. Same with sense gratification. The ears are always listening. The eyes are always receiving. And when I say ears, I mean ears plus mind. Because the mind in itself is a sense. When I say eyes, I mean eyes plus mind. When I say touch, I mean this plus what is happening. It is because I do not see the beautiful in the ordinary, in the commonplace, that I am always aiming for something that is more pleasing to the senses. I will never visit the park near my home, but I'll say I want to go to the hills because there are a lot of trees there. And there are enough number of trees in the park near your home as well. You never visit that. You never see the beauty of the ordinary tree in your own backyard. But what do you say? You say that tree over there is special. All right, that might be a bigger tree. That might be a different species. Have you seen how people keep pets? There are so many dogs on the road. Small puppies that often get killed under the tires of vehicles. And now that winter is approaching, they'll also die because of low temperature. But what will you do? You will go and you will bring some exotic species just because it looks more beautiful. And then you'll say, I am an animal lover. And you will display all kind of affection to that exotic puppy. While at that very moment, tens of puppies would be shivering in the cold right outside your door, and you are an animal lover and you have so much of concern for the puppy, and you are giving it bread and milk and whatnot, and you are giving it a nice little sweater and you're taking pics and putting them up on Facebook. And everybody who comes to your house, you are so fondly showing, see the puppy. And you move out and there is that street dog there, equally small puppy, and you kick it away. Dirty. Don't touch me. This is sense gratification. Just because it looks pleasing to the eye, the sense. Now tell me, if you cannot see the beauty in an ordinary puppy, can you really see the beauty in an exotic puppy? Can you? You cannot see the beauty in an ordinary tree in your own backyard or in the park in front of your home. Will you really be able to enjoy the beauty of the forest and the hills? This is sense gratification. It has nothing to do with the real. It has nothing to do with beauty. It only has to do with quantity. It only has to do with images. You have been told that such images are beautiful and you are running after them. And it goes to such an extent that all our love is actually just sense gratification. What do you think? You really love somebody? Look at all these couples going around. And they look very loving, holding hands, embracing each other, saying nice things to each other, eating out of the same plate, sleeping in the same bed. I don't know what all do they share, probably toothpaste, toothbrush. Something happens to the face of the girl or the boy. Will the relationship remain the same? The face gets totally distorted. She'll start looking like a witch. The boy will run away. In the night, he'll open his eyes, look at her, and he'll scream out of the bed. Call the police, maybe. Aliens have attacked my home, my bedroom. This love is nothing but sense gratification. Her face looks good. Her body looks good. The day the face is gone, everything is gone. But you tell this to him, you'll say, no, this is real love. Real love. Even mothers are known to do that. There would be two kids and one looks more beautiful. One is more shapely, more lively. This one takes away more of the mother's affection. And the other one feels deprived. Fathers are known to be more fond of daughters. Is that not so? All this is just sense gratification. It sounds crude, but yes, it's the male eye that is always more fond of a female face, even if the face is of a daughter. Our love, our relationships, what do we want except sense gratification? Big, more pleasing. And we also label that with very nice words. Reality, truth, beauty, love. Look at all these, what you call as massive hotels, your 5 stars and 7 stars. Do they really serve you food which is actually very different from the food that you are served in an ordinary joint? There are all these small eateries by the highway, close by. is the food served in a 7-star really very different from the food served here? But you are prepared to pay 200 times the amount because things look beautiful there. And that is not real beauty, mind you. Beauty is not what attracts the eye. But there you will have very clean floors and things will be nice, and there would be nice chandeliers and lights and walls and decorations, all kinds of ornamentation. And you are prepared to pay anything for that. For what? For something that pleases the eye. Eye candy. And that is also the status of our arts. Do you know what happens to you in a cinema hall? Your senses are totally filled up. The screen is so large. The eyes can see nothing but the screen. That's the difference between a TV set and a cinema screen. There the eyes can see nothing except the screen. So large. The sense is being completely dominated. And the sound. Such a booming sound that you can hear nothing else. Not even the sound of your own heart beating. And your senses are totally occupied. And you feel wow. Without realizing what is being done to me. Just the eyes and ears are being pleased. I'm pretty sure tomorrow they'll have means by which they'll be able to please other senses as well in cinema halls. So the heroine will walk in and there will be, you know, some outlets in the cinema hall which will exude a particular aroma, some scent. So she comes in and here your nose starts feeling nice. And you like that movie all the more. Do you see how you flock after 3D movies? What's special about a 3D movie? It pleases the eye all the more. And you feel as if, you know, the whole thing is there. I thought they only make science fiction in 3D. Now they are also making the Kama Sutra in 3D. For obvious reasons. It will be so very pleasing. All the dimensions, all the curves. You can see them in very extended way. That's what all your technology is for. To please the senses. Tomorrow they'll also include the sense of touch. So you won't only see a movie, you'll touch a movie. It's happening. You're able to touch. And then you won't need anything real. All you need is a movie. It is pleasing all the senses. Ask yourself, whatever I say about anything, how much of that has to do with its reality and how much of that has to do with its appearance? Whatever has to do with appearance is sense gratification. Have you seen how absolutely ridiculous lyrics of songs are passed off along with overpowering music? Some of these songs that you really like, if you remove the music part and just listen to the lyrics or just read the lyrics, you'll say, what nonsense. But you dance to the tunes of that very song purely because of the music. And the music is overpowering. The music takes you away from the lyrics. You can't even pay attention to what is being said. And what is being said is absolutely stupid. Not only stupid, it's poisonous. But you will dance to the tunes of that song because it's pleasing to the ear. And you don't even know what is pleasing to the ear. Why it is pleasing to the ear? It is pleasing to the ear only because the ear has been trained in that way. The eyes have been trained in that way. A particular taste has been given to them. The eyes have become accustomed to something, just as the tongue acquires a taste for something, right? And then you get something else to eat, you don't like it. There are certain people who are very fond of spicy meals. You give them something bland, they don't enjoy it. Now, there is nothing special about something spicy. It is just that they have been conditioned to eat a lot of spicy stuff. Right? Similarly, our eyes have been conditioned to look at a particular kind of face and say it is beautiful. Our ears, they have been so corrupted that they cannot enjoy the music of silence. All they can enjoy is loudness, harshness. Their basic nature has been taken away from them. You don't need to gratify the senses. We started with that, right?
Yes, sir.
Sense gratification is condemned because the senses are anyway all the time gratified, provided you do not corrupt them. We said wanting something is proof that I do not have it. Senses are anyway all the time gratified. As you sit in front of me, you are beautiful. Why should I want somebody else to sit in front of me? The same truth that will shine through anybody else shines through you also. Why should I want that a different face must be here, a different body must be here? This wanting senses are anyway all the time gratified. You hear a sound, and when you hear a sound, you must know that all the sounds emanate from the same source, and the source is silence. And the sense is gratified, already gratified. When I say sense, remember I mean sense plus mind. You do not need to go to special places. You do not need to look at fine pictures. You do not need to look at so-called pretty faces. Every face is beautiful. The same beauty shines through every face. And you will see that unless the mind has been conditioned otherwise. For example, the Indian mind has been conditioned to think of the white skin as especially beautiful. Which is an absolutely stupid thing, a very racist thing. But that's what we have come to. So many of these companies manufacturing toiletries and whitening creams, they dare to come on TV and they say that, you know, use this and your skin will become fair. They'll not be able to say that in many other countries because the population is aware and educated and will say, what are you telling us? Are you telling us that being dark is some sort of crime? But in India, they get away with saying absolutely ridiculous things. Use this, your skin will become fair. And their use, the use of such creams and everything, and such treatments and cosmetics is increasing by the day. Because our mind has been conditioned to think that only one color is all right, fair. And that too, if you investigate, you will come to know where that's coming from. This was not a land that worshipped any particular color. Even your gods and incarnations, they have been dark colored. Krishna, for example, But because of being colonized by white people for very long, the thought that there is something special about the white skin, that thought has dominated our mind now. So much so that if European people come in front of you, you'll develop a fondness towards them. And if there are European girls, some of you might say that we have fallen in love. And if African girls come over here, chances are, howsoever nice she may be, you will not say, I have fallen in love. That same girl might be considered very beautiful in her own country, but you will not say, I have fallen in love. Do you see the depth of our conditioning? And do you see the absolute ridiculousness of our love? When you say, I have fallen in love, it's just like a computer program saying, I am fallen in love. You are programmed to fall in love with only this person. How can anybody take your love seriously? How can you take your love seriously? How can she take your love seriously? Tomorrow something changes about her complexion, you will not love her no more. But going beyond the senses is to go into reality. Only the one who can appreciate, who can understand that there is something beyond what the eyes can see and beyond what the ears can hear, only he will say that I do not need sense gratification. The senses are already gratified. There is no desire to further gratify them. Only he can say that. Nobody else. And that requires a very sharp, a very intelligent mind. A very, very intelligent mind. A mind that is not easily fooled. A mind that has not been dumbed down by loads of influences. It requires that kind of a mind. Next time you go to purchase something and a particular dress appeals to you, ask yourself, why exactly is this dress appealing to me? And you will see the entire play of sense gratification. The more you inquire, the more you will laugh. Next time a particular color, a particular face, a particular smell appeals to you, ask yourself, what is happening? Do not just be drawn towards it. And you will only discover that you are conditioned. And when you discover that all this is just the conditioning of the mind, then there is great freedom. You are no more a slave of colors, of sounds, of touch, of smell, of people. You are no more a slave. You are very, very free. You know that all these attractions are just programming. There is nothing to them. They are just slavery of the mind. Why do I like a particular brand? I am programmed. Why do I like a particular food? I am programmed. Why do I like a particular flower? I am programmed. And then that does not mean that you will not like anything. Then everything will be beautiful. Then you won't have to run to the hills. Then you won't have to hunt for a specific person. Then life in its totality is beautiful. Then you don't have to go to worship a specific god in a specific temple. You can worship your neighbor. You can touch the feet of your own friend. Life in its completeness opens up. You are no more selective, no more choosy. You don't say, this is nice, this is ugly. I like to hear this, I don't like to hear this. I like to touch this, I don't like to touch this. Everything is nice and divine and full. And there is no need then to go and achieve the beautiful. The beautiful is right there in front of you. This moment is beautiful. You are beautiful. Your neighbor is beautiful. Your parents are beautiful. Every single blade of grass is beautiful. The brick is beautiful. The dog is beautiful. Take away sense gratification and there is nothing except beauty. Beauty alone exists. And you are in heaven without dying. Everything is beautiful. You getting it?